So, before actually ending the talk, I do want to talk about the data community ecosystem. Can I just get a quick show of hands of how many people have attended a data community event? Okay, and for data education, DC? All right, so it looks like, so who's new here? All right, cool, so we've got a mix of different people. So, Data Education DC is part of a larger umbrella organization called Data Community DC, and our goal is to foster data education in the DMV area. The other groups are Data Science DC, DSDC, WDSDC, DIDC, which is Data Innovation DC, DataViz, and we have a couple of others over there. So traditionally, we meet every month. We've had a couple of meetups more regularly in the last few weeks. And really the goal is to foster a community around data in the DMV area. We do this through speaking events, hackathons, workshops, and various conferences. So you can connect with Data Community DC at the bottom for sponsorship, the Twitter handle. So this will also be streaming live and we'll have a post on YouTube later, as well as through Facebook. So the pizza that you guys had outside was thanks to our sponsors, Booz, Microsoft, GW Business for providing us with this space, and AOL. One thing I will mention is we have this program called Datable. And so
what it aims to do is connect practitioners within the DMV area that have various data science skills with employers. So take a look at that. It should be datable.com, and you can find more information at Data Community
DC. And if this is something that you'd like your company to get involved with, feel free to come and talk with me.
Rami is going to talk about Blaze. I'll just say a couple of words about Rami. He's a senior software engineer at Continuum Analytics. He has, aside from speaking three human languages, and I found this on his website, he speaks, he codes in half a dozen computer languages. He also has a background in politics, philosophy, and economics, and it is undergraduate at Oxford and his master's at UCL in distributed systems and cloud systems. So with that, I'll hand it off to Rami and he'll walk the field.
So while I'm getting set up, I just want to double check if there's anyone who can't hear me. I know it's kind of a stupid question to ask, but raise your hand if you can't hear me.
I can hear you better, Matt.
Okay, thank you. That is it. I will try and speak up. If at any point I'm not speaking up sufficiently, just yell at me to talk louder. I would appreciate that a lot. I have a tendency to mumble. You are also going to have to forgive me for the occasional, over the screen. This isn't perfectly set up. But one of the first things that I actually want to say, thank you to Josh for the intro and to Data Education DC for giving me this opportunity to talk to you. The first thing I want to say is actually to address a couple of misnomers or misunderstandings about Blaze, and one of them is actually in the subtitle of this talk, Blaze, Super Fast Distributed Python. Well, it's Python, so it's not really super fast. Blaze facilitates some distributed applications, but it's not focused around distributed computation. So, Blaze, Python, distributed, yeah. Super fast. It really depends what you're doing, right? So, Blaze, the fundamental tenet of Blaze that I want to focus on here is flexibility. Blaze is about flexibility with your data, and yes, it will make things fast, if you let it. yes, it can work in a distributed fashion if you optimize for that. But Blaze is fundamentally a way to work with your data in a flexible way. So who here is, you know, ETL kind of stuff? Who here liked it? Okay, no, cool. Well, one of the great things about Blaze is that as a library, it lets you, or it helps you avoid that sort of thing. So because I like structuring my presentations and moving the layout in advance, what I'm going to do, what I'm going to talk about, we'll take a look at what the library can do, why you might be interested, and then we'll delve a little bit into how it works and, you know, other related work to have a look at. There are going to be links in the slides. Last time I gave this presentation, we had a couple of issues with contrast, and I apologize in advance for those. But this is also available online, so you'll be able to look everything up and run the accompanying Jupyter notebook. So I'm going to let the marketing spiel from the website actually define Blaze for me.
It presents a pleasant and familiar interface to us regardless of our computational solution or database. So that means Spark, Impala, SQL databases, NoSQL stores, raw flat files. One Blaze query can work across data, ranging from a CSV
file. And you're like, okay, well, one query works across different systems. Well, that's nice. But, you know, do we need another query language? Do we need another DSL? We don't. Blaze tries very hard to do. Those ones are NumPy. NumPy does data frame syntax. And it, what it does, it translates those operations to whatever makes sense for the underlying data store. Whether that's formatting as SQL, calling, how optimized by canvas functions. Because I think talks are no fun without examples. For the purposes of this talk, we're going to pretend that we're working on an online bookstore that happens to be named after a rainforest. For no particular reason, no
So what we have is we have books. Books are stored in MongoDB, so we can manage them easily and serve them fast. And we have user profiles and libraries, and those are in Postgres as well, because we don't want to lose them. We have a purchase and history data dump, which is in CSV, because we're smart, and we're letting someone else add a document to send us a data file and so on. And we have web server logs, and those are coming from Kibana or something, and accessing it in CSV format, and JSON works as well. So the idea is that these are coming from our aggregation system, somewhere over VGD.
I will note that generally JSON works just as well as CSV. This example is in CSV, because I found a bug in Blaze since JSON happening while I was preparing this talk. So now, we're going to look out. This is where I open a Jupyter notebook and I fiddle.
And things break, so do bear with me.
Say
get the top five big spenders. So
and if we take our transaction user ID and we group by that using the Blaze by operator here, which is just like kind of state of group by.
And then we add here, we give it kind of that consumption, you know, that aggregation column. The spend is the purchase price sum. So that, you know, that looks fairly intuitive. It looks like Python syntax that we're used to. And then we say, okay, we're going to sort it by that new column that we created, the spend column. And then we're going to take the top five out of that. Okay. So we know that, you know, this user ID spent $37, this one spent $35. Obviously, this is not a high volume bookstore. This is not going to challenge any other bookstores that happen to be named after Rainforest anytime soon. But this should give us sort of an illustration of, okay, well, this is how easy it is to take something like a CSV and do, you know, not completely trivial computations on it. So, next step, we care about our fictional users. And so we store them in Postgres. And all we need to tell Blaze is the data URL connection string. Your end can access them for us. So data set is generated from this random data generator, generatedata.com. It's, you know, it's been munched a little bit, but it should be pretty random. All, you know, all disclaimers apply. So again, we use bz.data. That's our way of creating a data access object. And it works consistently and generically no matter what string you pass to it. In this case, it's a database URL. It looks like a database URL. That's enough for Blaze to figure out what to do. So we have our users database. Can we take the top five there? So, you know, we have these folks, we have their email addresses, we have a bunch of pieces of information about them. And we have their state of residence because, I don't know, we want to charge them different sales taxes or something like that. So, okay, we say, okay, well, again, let's do a little group by, let's do a little aggregation to explore our data set. How many men and women do we have for our customers of our bookstore? So we, again, use that easy.by, group by the users.gender. So we'll notice that the dot gender is available as a column of that database. And then we can have that count, because again, the user.count. Just like dot sum is another operation that's available with Blaze. Then we sort by that count, and then, okay, so we have 50 men, 50 women, 43 men, and 7 people who declined to state their gender or otherwise don't fit into a binary, which is good, you know, we're inclusive in our fictional bookstore. Okay, and now we get into something a little bit more interesting. We also store user and book relationships in Postgres, in our fictional example. So, you know, viewing them, equally simple, passing the same connection string. Blaze is going to do a little bit of caching for us under the hood, so it'll pull that connection and be a little more intelligent about it. And for those who are interested, yes, that is SQL on the hood. So, you know, who has how many books? Who has which books? That's the first one, and then we say, okay, well, who has how many? Again, just like our previous group by, we're just summing here and then sorting by the sum column. And so we see that again, we are not a high volume bookstore, we don't have a lot of people with a lot of books, but we do have some people who have at least 10 books, and that's something, right? So our books, on the other hand, our books are stored in MongoDB. And they're stored in MongoDB for a variety of reasons. The main real one thing that I wanted another data store to demonstrate here, but you know, if I were building this, I could see a bunch of reasons for storing things in MongoDB. It's fast, you know, they're fundamentally JSON documents, you know, presumably they're coming from some other archive, so we don't care, they're MongoDB, tends to throw away your data. So this data set actually demonstrates one of the shortcomings of Blaze pretty well, which is that Blaze likes to know it's either a shortcoming or an advantage, depending on how you look at it. Blaze likes to know the shape of your data. With an SQL database, this is pretty easy. Your data sets are defined in your columns. Everything's fine. So Blaze knows that a float is a float and an int is an int. And you have these columns. With a CSV or something like that, similarly, you can do some inference. You can kind of go, okay, well, you know, the first 100 rows of this look like integer or decimal data, so I can decide on that. My columns are fairly fixed as well. With MongoDB, with our documents here, we have no idea. Like, one record can be one shape, one record can be the next record can be a completely different shape. We don't know. So in order to enable Blaze to reasonably compute across this, we have to tell Blaze the actual shape of our data. So here we're using what we do is we create a Blaze resource. That's our connection to MongoDB. And then in order to actually create the Blaze data, we need to tell it the shape of that resource, the shape with which it should perform computations on that data. So we use a data description language called DataShape, which is another project sort of in the Blaze ecosystem, allows you to describe your data in a fairly simple sort of intuitive structural fashion. So var star means, you know, we have a variable number of these things, these records, which are shaped like this, ID, author, so on. And so in order to create our data, we say, okay, well, here's the resource, here's the data shape, and then we can actually look at the first few. So as you see, we have several classic books. This is all great. We have Capitalism Made Easy, we have The Life and Adventures of Robinson Crusoe. You know, someone might want to do all of these in one sitting, right? Cool, so then you can say, okay, what is the average price per author with multiple books? You know, we're using the exact same structures that we were before.
Right, yeah, if you don't mind a question. Are you limited by the shape of the data from the source? Like if I have a tabular data, it has a structure. Can I say that it's not that structure, like to eliminate columns or?
Yes. Okay. So you certainly can. You can by structuring by giving Blaze a data shape string, you can basically override whatever it is. Okay. If you have an actual table that has a better structure, I would definitely advise that because Blaze is smart enough to exclude the columns that you don't care about in your computations. This is a thing that I should have said at the beginning of the talk. If you have a question, please just raise your hand and yell at me. So I appreciate that very much.
So what about columns with mixed data type? Let's say someone drew a string and they entered their column.
So
would it coerce the string or?
So by default it won't. It depends very much on the back end as well because Blaze, like I said, is flexible. Blaze isn't sucking all this data in and doing computation.
So we're going to pan this back end.
So if you, so.
Or just a CSV.
Right, so if it's just a CSV, you know, pan is going to decide that dtype is object because it's detected that string. And so it's not necessarily going to be able to, you know, intelligently perform some of these computations, but it won't crash it. And it will mean Blaze is confused. But it's not going to restrict your ability. It will probably mean that if you're trying to say sum that column, But as you see, one of the things that you can do with all of these group bys and all these operations that we're doing, we're actually chaining them, and we're chaining them, you know, relatively straightforward. I deliberately created new variables for every step in this computation just for clarity, but you could actually, you know, you could build that complex expression in one go if you really wanted to. The idea here is that, you know, everything that you create with Blaze, every single Blaze expression that you create is itself a Blaze expression and you can perform more computations on it. So build up and compose arbitrarily complex expressions using the same simple operators. So now we say, okay, what is the average price per author? And this is per author that has multiple books. And we see that, you know, the most expensive author that we have on average is Nietzsche, because I guess demand is relatively inelastic for Nietzsche. Really want Nietzsche or you just don't care. and then you have Oscar Wilde, which kind of makes sense. You know, he's a smart guy, he's really witty. And then we have, of course, Anonymous, who, as we all know, is the best author of the world, right? In case anyone accuses me of having specific messages that I tried to push in this talk, bear in mind all of these questions were randomly generated by a script that I wrote, so you know. Flame, Python's random module for having biases. And last but not least, we have our server logs here. And these are relatively straightforward. Like I said, they're treated as CSV, but they're being served over HTTP. And the point there, the thing that I want to demonstrate here is that Blaze is consuming this data completely apart from us actually having that connection. So we just give Blaze a URL, and Blaze is able to fetch and stream that data for us. It's able to take care of all the complexities here. So you know, we have a URL, we have a content length, user timestamp, et cetera, et cetera. So we can say, okay, what are filter out log entries that don't refer to that one? So we have a bunch of log entries in here that you know refer to user profile, stuff like that, for you know, very similar to. And so we find them out. Okay? And then let's plot some request times because plots are good. So here we're pulling in Bokeh, which is a visualization, web-based visualization library that allows you to write Python code for your visualization to not learn a lot of JavaScript. And then we create our data frame because Bokeh, which is a visualization library, is not super keen on Blaze expressions. And it wants a data frame, so then you know, we display that. Hey, here we go. As you see, you know, mostly we're doing reasonably well, but occasionally we have quite a few spikes and some things that take a long time to download. We really gotta, you know, try and figure out what those are. So let's look at all requests above the 99th percentile request time. I am not a statistician, so I had to look up this formula. I'm a software developer, I had to look up this formula. Which, you know, not a complex formula, but I think one of the cool things that this demonstrates is you can do, it's not complex, but you can do math at Blaze. And Blaze is able to take whatever expressions that you're actually trying to do and pass them on to the back end and come up with that. So you can, you know, compute this formula relatively straightforwardly at Blaze. So here are our most egregious violators in terms of request time. And again, this doesn't tell us very much. So the next step, and I have a slide for this, but I'm just going to step one step further through the slide. The next step is, okay, we've seen Blaze work with all of these individual data sets, and that's cool. But each of these data sets is a thing that you could work with on your own. You could pull up an SQL workbench or something like that and work with your SQL table. You could, you know, pull up pandas on your own in your IPython section and work with your CSV. Where Blaze gets really interesting is where you can actually combine all these data sets. You know? Some of you might be wondering, okay, well, why isn't all your data in one place to begin with? Why isn't it all in Postgres or AWS Redshift or whatever? And ours is not to wonder why. Okay? Very often, I know as a developer, all of you guys as data practitioners very often were called upon to work with this in whatever shape you find it. So we don't necessarily have the option to say, okay, well, we're going to spin up this Redshift cluster and dump all of our data in here, and then we can analyze it. That's ridiculous. So this is where Blaze gets really interesting because we're using the same language, the same structures, and the same code to actually work with data across different data sets, stored in different places, some of which is inconveniently large and you can't pull it into an in-memory data frame, and so on. So, you know. Hold on, I'm just trying to. So, now we can go back here. Okay, cool. So, combining, hooray! We're going to say, okay, which gender has spent the most on books? This combines our users, which are in Postgres, and our transactional objects, CSV dump. And you'll notice all of these queries are kind of funky and messy. But that's what happens with data, right? So if we go and look at this, we say, okay, well, I'm running, he really wants to know which gender spent the most on books, so we know what to set up for the next, for the next Christmas sale or whatever. Black Friday, I guess, more appropriate. Turns out, generally speaking, it turns out overall, men have spent the most, considering there are fewer men than women on the site. That means men spend more. Cool. Let's, you know, then do some further analysis to figure out which types of books men tend to buy and then try to promote them, I guess. Then I'm not a marketer either. But let's look at, okay, which genre has had the most spent on it overall? This combines our books and our transactions. Because we need to know from our MongoDB, from our books database, what genres are involved in our transactional logs, so it tells us all about who spent what. And so it turns out, you know, English literature is the most popular, the most commonly spent on thing. So great, men tend to spend on English literature. Let's, you know, let's find some good English literature to market to men. Just as an example, right? Okay, and then let's look at something that you might think that's a little more whimsical. In which state have people spent the longest time downloading philosophy books? This is largely, this is partly contrived, obviously, in order to demonstrate the fact that Blaze can take, you know, as in all of these previous examples, and this combines users, server records, and books data. You know, we have our book data. And because Mongo sucks, we need to pull out specific columns, otherwise we'll try and load all of the columns because Mongo. And then we do a little bit of transformation to make sure our IDs all line up, our titles all line up. We do a little transformation to to something to create an intermediate view. Remember, it's not actually an intermediate table or anything in memory, it's just an expression that represents that, so we don't actually have to, you know, handle the infrastructure to load all that up. Make sure that everything lines up, and then we say, okay, we're taking all of these things and we're joining a whole bunch of different data sets together. And all of this is in the same code, all of this looks fairly similar, it's fairly uniform, same syntax, same language, allows you to, you know, write Python functions that get evaluated in line so you can manipulate your data on the fly. And then we're joining all of these things that live in several different places in several different formats. And then we're joining them up, and in a second, we're going to execute it. And so we can see that people in Alaska evidently spend the most time downloading philosophy books. And that's most is people in Wyoming. So, you know, clearly we have a lot of people in remote cabins somewhere reading philosophy in their spare time. And I gotta tell you, I want to meet some of these people because they sound interesting. You know, they probably had a lot of time to contemplate things. But one of the things that I want to demonstrate with this is I've been giving sort of marketing related examples. A lot of people can obviously reach useful conclusions from this data, including, in this case, our DevOps people for our fictional website who might want to say, oh, we have a lot of people spending a lot of time downloading philosophy books. Turns out they're not actually downloading a lot of philosophy books. They're just spending a lot of time doing it because we don't have a CDN endpoint in Alaska or near Alaska, so we need to build that in. And so these are conclusions that you can bring to all parts of a business, all parts of an organization, just from being able to combine lots of different pieces of data. These are the sorts of things that we all know as data practitioners, but it's a lot easier when you can sell it as kind of, well, here's the thing that will let us do all of this stuff. So now, let me go back to my slides and talk about how does all of this work and, you know, and why you care so much. Well, first thing to say is it supports a range of file formats and storage systems. So all of these analyses that I was talking about with CSV, with SQL, with JSON flat files, with MongoDB, we support all of that. We support this HDF5, there's Spark, PySpark integration, there's BCALS, which if you're familiar with it, is a simple columnar database store. At some point soon, we're going to get Apache Parquet support. So there's a lot of different things that you can combine here. And for various business reasons, for various operational reasons, you might have data in a lot of different formats and a lot of different places. The place can help you interact with all of them, basically the same. Okay, so I've told you a lot about what Blaze can do and why you might want to care about Blaze. Let's look a little bit at how we use Blaze, right? A couple of key APIs. Blaze resource creates a string, translates the string, pointing the data into a Python object, pointing to the same data. Blaze is lazily evaluated. It doesn't actually do any computation unless you tell it to. So when you create a Blaze resource, you're basically saying, here's a pointer to some data, but Blaze has done some evaluation. Blaze has, you know, tried to figure out its shape if necessary, and so Blaze knows how to work with it. And the cool thing about this is, you know, creating new resource types is really easy. You pull in a decorator and you say, okay, here's a function that allows me to translate that resource type into another resource type that Blaze understands. Under the hood, Blaze actually works using an enormous sort of graph of different types of data and ways to transform them into one another. And it has a lot of different, sort of more powerful nodes in that graph, which are nodes at which it knows how to do computation. So if you write a function that allows you to translate your resource of whatever type into something that's already in that graph, you've basically created another node in that graph, and Blaze can then deploy its full power of computation across different backends, you know, by traversing that graph to your new node. So here we're saying XLS files, we're going to use pandas read Excel function to translate that into a data frame, and then Blaze knows how to deal with the data frame, and knows how to translate that data frame into SQL or JSON or whatever else it needs. And so now this is part of that graph. You can now create resources that are Excel files and do go nuts from that. Compute. So this is the one that's kind of been hidden so far, but this is actually what does all the work. It evaluates an expression against a set of resources. So far I've been demonstrating stuff, because for demonstration purposes it's really easy to look at an interactive piece of data. But under the hood, Blaze is really dealing with all of these things as expressions. These are expressions, this is sort of a DSL, if you will, for computation. If you're doing that computation, you don't necessarily need to have the data associated with it right there. You can say, well, here's the expression we want to perform. The data will come there. It's lazily evaluated. So you can say, okay, here's the expression. I've tested it out on my local SQLite data store, and now it's going to run against, you know, the production Oracle cluster. All we have to do is change the data that it wants. It's the same expression. And then what combines those is Blaze data. So combines resources and compute. So Blaze data, Blaze compute over resources. It basically combines the two. It's really handy, as I've been showing, for interactive exploration. You know, it might not be what you want to do in production, but it's super handy for your data. And so expressions. Full documentation for the expressions is at the link join, group by, concat, transform, merge, absolute value, standard deviation, a whole bunch of stuff. But Blaze expressions currently support if you want to add more. We'll talk about that later. So now let's look quickly at how Blaze does what it does. And like I said, fundamentally Blaze is all about expressions. Expressions, like in many programming languages, like in many implementations, are trees of operations. So internally, there's lots of detail in the design document. I strongly recommend you read it if you are that kind of nerd, as I am. But you can create a tree and actually see the structure of your expression easily. You know, this is a field operation. It's extracting a field, extracting a set of fields from another symbol, and that symbol has this shape, and so on and so forth. And that basically composes all the expressions end up being composed into this giant tree, and that tree is eventually what gets evaluated across various nodes. So that's the heart of many businesses. So how does this do that? Well, okay, first you take your tree, right? You pre-compute all of the leaves of the tree that represent your data. So step one, can, for example, load your data into memory. So now you have this tree, and this tree is pointing to concrete bits of data. Then you optimize it. So you take your expression, Blaze has a little bit of smarts in it to, you know, eliminate columns you don't care about, lower things to backends that know how to do efficient operations. Let's say you have a column in your data store, and all you want is, you know, sums of certain columns. Great, it'll lower that expression, that optimization, that summing, down to the columns in the data store that knows how to do that efficiently. And then you try to compute down the entire expression tree. That usually doesn't work. And otherwise, we traverse up our tree from the leaves, column compute, not trying to basically collapse each stage of our tree a little further. And then, you know, we repeat this until the data significantly changes type. And, you know, here, for example, as we're evaluating chunks of our expression tree, maybe through the processing backend, you could, you know, restructure it and send off some expressions to be evaluated in parallel, and so on. And you know, then we reevaluate our optimize because things have changed. Our situation might have changed. We're doing a lot of stuff here at runtime. Go to step three, and then finally, at an end, we call post-compute. And post-compute is really handy because, for instance, if you're computing this tree, and this tree ultimately is going to be evaluated on an SQL database or a pair of SQL databases, let's say, eventually your tree turns into an SQL expression, which has been optimized and replaces some stuff to it. But then you need to send that SQL expression off to your database server and then stream the results back. And so that's where it plays. So internally, how does this actually look? Well, Blaze internally uses a lot of multiple dispatch. And multiple dispatch is basically, it's a way of looking at functions that take a certain set of arguments and return a certain type of result. And then take that exact same concept, so our compute function here, which is secretly the most common function in Blaze, but not so secret. But it's the most common hidden function in place where we're saying, okay, we want to compute up, we want to collapse some set of pieces of data, we want to do this over a selection and a couple of sequences. Okay, so here's how we do it. This is what implements a lot of Blaze's flexibilities, because you can implement a new compute up, a new way of dispatching across a different set of data types, and then all of a sudden you know how to Blaze knows how to handle those data types and knows how to do so efficiently. So, you know, we're expecting two sequences, one of which is our data, one of which is a predicate. Blaze, you know, zips them up, filters them out. As we've seen, these are also lazy functions in Python, so Blaze is not doing anything yet. It's returning a generator that will actually evaluate. So, one last thing to kind of point out, Blaze has a server. Everyone loves servers. Servers are awesome. Right? Servers are where we want everything to happen, and that will connect APIs and mobile apps and other fun things. But Blaze server, to be less facetious, is combining that Blaze concept with a simple REST API. So the Blaze server hosts references to your data. It's basically the host for your resources. It's the place where you can evaluate your expressions. So then you have a Blaze client, which talks to your Blaze server. Blaze colon slash slash is your URL. The Blaze client talks to your Blaze server, acts exactly like any other set of Blaze expressions. It will do whatever computation it can, and then it will send the rest of that expression over to the server, and your server does all the work. It does all the computation. So let's say you have a Blaze server that has, you know, you have a lot of smaller Blaze clients that don't have a lot of computation power. You have a big Blaze server that has references to all your data, can pull a lot of them into memory. Well, you know, then you're basically sending your expressions over there to be computed. And one of the great things about this is it allows you to write the same kind of code, think about your data in the same way, but allow a lot of the logic of, okay, well, who's allowed to do what to what data set, whatever. You can centralize all that stuff on the server, which is kind of fun. And then, you know, you can make sure that, say, your individual developer workstations don't need access to the database tokens to get copy the data and so on. Okay, so we're just going to do a quick survey of what else is in place, what else is there in this whole ecosystem, and then just wrap up and do a little Q&A if anyone has any questions. So, Odo. Who here knows where that name came from? Yay! My friends. For those who didn't get the joke, Odo is a shapeshifter from Star Trek Deep Space Nine. And Odo, surprise, surprise, left your data shapeshift. The idea is that it takes your data, knows, this is the heart of the actual Blaze graph that I was talking about that has different data types, and just Odo employs the same principle, and it knows how to translate, you know, one format to another. So CSV to PostgreSQL, for example, Postgres drivers have some optimized load operations and dump operations for CSVs. That is an optimized edge in your graph. Odo knows how to traverse that graph of different data types and, you know, find the most efficient way of translating different shapes. So if it doesn't have, you know, CSV to whatever your format is, else to something else, and then eventually you'll get to your format, and you know, Odo is actually using Dijkstra's algorithm to block that graph in the best possible way, so you know, you don't spend a lot of time waiting for your data. But I not only like the name, it's also really be happy for moving your data around. Data shape. What I was saying about the data shape. Sorry.
Sorry, I didn't quite understand why the Odo is
So, I mean, so let's say you have, so here, for example, let's say you've got a PostgreSQL database and you want to load a CSV data dump, right? You want to do that in a one-off fashion. So Odo lets you do that. Odo lets you do that in a whole bunch of different formats. Occasionally, you know, you have to move data around, write a little script and use Odo, and instead of being 50 lines, it's 50. So, data shape. Data shape, like I said, you're describing the data. Need a description language for it. DataShape is that description language. It's also a Python library that implements that shape processing and that recognition. That sort of thing, which Blaze internally uses to kind of check and sanity, check and verify that your expressions are going to make sense. So if you do something using a column that you don't have, for example, Blaze is going to know, well, you can't do that. A DataShape is part of what makes that possible. Also provides this nice description language, and there are lower level bindings using C and C++ for lower level operations. If you are interested in learning more, the DYND project, that's D-Y-N-D, is a good place to look. That's the lower level project. So I just spent all this time singing the praises of Blaze and describing it a little bit and saying, okay, well, it's the best thing ever. Best thing since last spread, go use it for all your data. Other data access, other data transformations. Obviously, it has limitations. I don't want anyone to go away thinking that it can do everything and then being disappointed when it can't. It's one of the reasons that I put that disclaimer right up at the beginning to say it's not going to make anything super fast. So what is it? What does it not do? Well, it's not going to clean up your messy data. I'm sorry. You can definitely use Blaze to write your kinib scripts. You can definitely use it to simplify your ETL syntax. But it's not necessarily going to automatically remove the nulls or the nans, or you know, remove that random string value from your integer column or whatever. It can help you do that, but it's not going to do it for you. There's a lot of stuff from SciPy and SciKit as well that's generally out of scope right now for Blaze. If you'd like to contribute them for different backends, that would be awesome. Or build Blaze plugins that will do that. That would be awesome. Right now, Blaze doesn't do a lot of that complex stuff. Also, it doesn't make your existing data handling code magic or parallel or distributed. So, you know, it will take your operation, it will try and do some optimizations. Like I said, it's going to re-optimize that tree. It's going to try and push the operations to different backends that know how to handle them well. But it's not going to automatically parallelize or you know, find the points at which all your operations can be run together or something. And like I said, it doesn't necessarily make everything super fast. If you're, say, if part of your computation graph is talking to an SQL database, you know, it's going to generate okay SQL. It's going to generate pretty good SQL, to be honest. If you know your SQL and you know how to have a hand to your joins, it's probably not going to beat that. Also, terrible things. It has poor MongoDB support. I, for one, am not going to shed that many tears over it because I don't really like MongoDB personally. But it has poor MongoDB support. If you would like to work more with MongoDB and you would like to use Blaze to do so, please contribute. A lot of people do like it, want to use it for analytical stuff. And the final downside to Blaze that I found is debugging can be kind of a pain in the ass. Because of the multiple dispatch stuff that I've already mentioned, because it's designed, you know, lazily to compute across potentially large data sets, and you know, lazy computation in any way, shape, or form is kind of a pain in the butt. This can be a bit of a bear to the butt. But don't let all of that stuff put you off. Blaze does make your life a lot easier in a lot of cases, and you know, I've used it in production in a number of situations where it's taken a lot of big complicated code and made it simpler, allowed us to you know, compose operations better, and allow, you know, more data scientists and people to write data access code, and otherwise someone who SQL or you have optimized CSV loads have to get in and get involved. So that's it for me. That's my prepared bit. Obviously, I'm open to any Q&A, anything that you guys want. I may not have the answers, but tweet at me or connect with me on GitHub, and I will try and point you in the right direction. As Josh said at the beginning, I work for Continuum Analytics, which supports Blaze, but it's fully open source. We don't own the project, we support it. It's under a permissive license, so go nuts. Trying to do compute down basically is an optimization there. You could try and compute down from your leads, or you could compute down from the top. If your expression is sufficiently shallow, it's usually quicker. Just compute down from the top. Try and class the directory. Like I said, usually doesn't work. Usually your expression, if you're doing anything interesting, your expression is complex enough that that won't work. Awesome. Well, if no one has any more questions, like I said, get me on Twitter or GitHub at Necaris. Go out and use Blaze, and enjoy working with data. Thanks for coming.